And speaking of the proposed, the plan, June 15, 3 days after our Independence Day celebration, the plan of China to really detain for 60 days without trial any fishermen near the areas that they illegally claim, I think it will trigger, Karen, a lot of violations. And this is really, although we don't want this to happen, this is really, at this stage, this is really, again, I'm calling the DFA to really study several precedents on this. We have the case before of three Ukrainian naval vessels detained by Russia in 2019. We have the illegal detention of Mexican nationals by the United States, also in a disputed area, and a lot of other cases. So dapat pag-aralan tong maaga, and we can now invoke, we can now plan at this early stage the Vienna Convention, the utilization of the Vienna Convention on Consular Relations. So dapat ganito kaaga pa lang, proactive na yung DFA, utilize. We have a consulate in somewhere near that area. Utilize that office to really require the Chinese authorities, if they indeed would detain our fishermen, kung kukulong nila yon, to inform us, to allow the presence of not just consular officials, but even their relatives to visit them. Kung gagawin nila, ang dami nilang i-violate na batas, including international humanitarian law. So, Karen, siguro dapat pag-isipan maigi ng China yan kung gagawin nila yan sa June 15. So, uulanin sila ng batikos dyan kahit isang mangingisda natin mula sa Zambales ang kanilang huhulihin.
Oo. That's a very good point. And when it comes to the maritime zones law, I think domestically speaking, it's very important also so that an incoming president or the next president or whoever the president may be can't just change their foreign policy when it comes to dealing with China on the West Philippine Sea, because they'd have then to implement the law. And if the maritime zones law is very clear on what a sitting president must do, they have no choice for reinterpretation.
I agree, Karen, because the Maritime Zones Law, once signed and approved by the president, will have to be submitted to the United Nations Secretary General, not just for compilation, but for dissemination to all member states, including states which are not signatory to the UNCLOS. So it will be part of the global regime of laws, Karen. So tama ka, it will make the next president abide by the Maritime Zones Law, and not just the law that would be, but including the progenies of the Maritime Zones Law, so including the Archipelagic Sea Lanes Law and others.
Okay, let me now change the topic. Let's talk about POGO. All right. Now, of course, there have been Senate hearings on the controversial Bantarlak Mayor Alice Go. But the bigger issue, there's one issue of her citizenship. Is she really a Filipino? Was she allowed, or is she actually, can she really run for public office? But the bigger issue really here is POGO. At the end of the day, those POGO outlets in Bantarlak were given PAGCOR licenses. Yes, they didn't have certain permits, but at the end of the day, they were licensed by PAGCOR. And that isn't the only POGO hub licensed by PAGCOR. Island Cove in Cavite is also, that in Tarlac, that's 7.5 hectares. In Island Cove, I believe that's 13 hectares. And you are, I mean, you're a local of Tagaytay, right? In Cavite, so this isn't new to you. And that's a whole other universe also, wherein I don't know if our local officials can enter that particular space. But the overall issue here is POGO. The fact that President Marcos Jr. has not banned POGO in the Philippines. Where do you stand when it comes to POGO?
I think going beyond the Bamban issue, and I would not comment on the status of that, because in 15 minutes there's going to be an executive session. I will still have to navigate the traffic at all going to the Senate. I think they will discuss the intricacies of this, how was it issued a license, whether the regulatory functions were indeed properly flexed, how was she able to get a birth certificate and others. So this will be discussed in an executive session.
But that's not no longer my issue. My issue is really, the real issue is POGO.
Yes.
It's legal in China, and yet it is legal in the Philippines. Why?
I think there was a previous congressional imprimatur to authorize the PAGCOR as part of a revenue generation scheme for the government during the lockdown, during the pandemic. Though I'm not very privy to the insight, quote unquote, of this, as part of the revenue stream of the government. So regulation as between total ban in consideration of social ills, you consider morals, would have to be weighed. And I think the president is just implementing a congressional authorization, and that's the same with PAGCOR, and the same goes through with casinos, the same goes through with other online betting sites, Karen. So there has got to be a proper balance on this. Hard work, ethics, the ethics of hard work, and real flexing of muscles to generate not manual labor, but to generate that the proper income for individuals should not be given just to the game of chance. It has to be done through labor. It has to be commensurate to what a yeah. worker has
but,
done.
But so, do you support a POGO ban in the Philippines, or are you for legalizing, are you for regulating POGO and allowing
the current,
it?
The current stream of thought, Karen, is for a ban, but there has got to be a transition. If we consider the thousands of locals that would be affected, and we're not talking here of the illegal Chinese, but we're talking here of those who were displaced during the pandemic, who were able to acquire work. These are college graduates, not just from southern Tagalog, but from other areas as well. So there's got to be a transition period. In the interim, where do we place them looking moving forward? How do we absorb them in the labor market, Karen? So if the ban would be total, I think the current idea of some of my colleagues, and not referring to all of them, is that it has to be phased in perhaps 2 years, 3 years before a total ban, considering the effect on the labor market. Because we right now, if you consider the employment rate, PSA records, it doesn't sound that good.
Do you even have the numbers? Just how many Filipinos are really employed by legal POGOs? Because to run a POGO,
I'm not defending POGOs, need, Karen.
No, yeah, but
I'm not defending POGOs.
They need to import. They need to import Chinese workers, because you'd have to be speaking fluent Chinese to be actually manning the online POGO.
I am. If your question is this, are you in favor of gambling? No, I'm not. I don't gamble, Karen. You can check that out. Hindi nga ako marunong magsabong eh. But ang sinasabi ko lang dito, may mga kababayan tayong empleyado ngayon na baka naman, yun din ang sinasabi ng iba mga kasama ko at naririnig ko sa iba, baka naman outright mawala ng hanap buhay. Yun ang dapat natin pangalagaan. saan natin sila ilalagay.
But are there numbers? Do we at least know how many Filipinos and what do they do?
I think they run into thousands.
Are they admin assistants? Are they receptionists? Ano sila?
Yes, they run into thousands.
To man the POGO, yes. You'd have to be speaking for
whether we're talking of 10,000, 12,000, or even 10 Filipinos, hindi naman tayo papayag na may 10 Filipino na hindi dahil sa hindi nila kagustuhan ay mawala ng hanap buhay. May mga pamilya rin po yun. Kahit po yun lima, lalong-lalo na kung mga kababayan ko po sa Southern Tagalog.
But that would be a poor measure to what?
Isn't
that like a poor measure to, I'm just curious, to we talk about the social ills, but yes. Along with POGO, even if POGO is legalized, along with POGO comes human trafficking, prostitution.
Yes. I agree.
So, I mean, we talk about giving Filipinos job, but that's the return. So my question is it really worth it? There are many Asian countries that have already banned POGO.
Yes.
Not the Philippines. But not the Philippines. Cambodia, no more POGO. Vietnam, no more POGO.
I was even interviewed before when I was in Cambodia during the, I think, those Southeast Asian Games, na mayroong mga nahuling Pilipino, human trafficking, tapos pagbalik dito, binalik ng ating embahada, pagbalik dito, wala rin trabaho, bumalik uli doon. Nagtrabaho uli doon, the same line of occupation, Karen. So nakikita mo yung agam-agam dito. I'm not defending POGO. Yeah. Sa akin, ayoko ng gambling. Ang ayoko lang po ay yung biglang mawala ng trabaho ang ating mga kababayan. Pero yung social, other social ills, prostitution, drugs, hindi na natin ho yung pinag-usapan. I am totally against all of those.
Mm. All right. Well, I want to thank you, Senator Francis Tolentino, for joining me today. And I do hope you can update us. I know you'll be rushing to the executive session. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, ma'am. And good morning to all.